Thank you for joining me today. Open your Bibles to Ephesians chapter 6. Ephesians chapter 6. Today we'll be looking at verse number 15. You follow along and I'll read it. And your feet shod with the preparation of the gospel of peace. Let us pray. Dear Heavenly Father, I thank you so much for this opportunity to come and learn more about you. I pray, Lord, you help us. Lord, be not just a hearer of your word, but a doer of it also. I pray, Lord, you help us all to apply this lesson to our lives, Lord, that we would just cherish the gospel of peace, and Lord, we would want to share it with others. We pray, Lord, you help us. We love you and we praise you. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Now, if you've noticed the word in here, shod. Have you ever heard anybody use the word shod? I have said the horses are getting their feet shod today. Not shot, but shod. That when you read the verse number 15, it says, "And your feet shod with the preparation of the gospel of peace." What that meant for my horses today is getting new shoes put on their feet. What this is talking about is your shoes being applied to your feet. If you're putting your shoes on, I don't know if you're like me. A lot of times when I'm at the house, I'm either running around in the house barefoot, or I've got a pair of socks on, but I'm not always ready to go right outside. What do I have to do to get ready to go outside? I stop at the door, or either one of the doors, and I stop and put my shoes on. That's what this is talking about, is stopping to put your shoes on. And every day, we need to have our spiritual shoes on, ready to share. What does it say that we're supposed to do? It's with the preparation of the gospel of peace, prepared to share the gospel. Now, I know if you talk about witnessing, sometimes that it sounds intimidating. I know that in myself, when I think of going out purposefully to go witness, sometimes that's a little intimidating to me because I'm already thinking about what could happen, what could take place, what if I say the wrong thing. But then I'm going to remind you, like I have to remind myself every time I think about those kind of things, is that we have to go back to the basics. What does it mean to witness? What is a witness? I looked it up in the dictionary. Merriam-Webster dictionary says that you're attesting of a fact or an event. It's a testimony, one that gives evidence. One asked to be present at a transaction so as to be able to testify to having taken place. So you're there to testify about what you witnessed, what you saw, what you experienced. One who has personal knowledge of something. So when you think about witnessing, don't get intimidated by witnessing, because you're just simply sharing what you have experienced. Now, if you happen to drive up to the scene of an accident and there's a police officer there, do you think that he's going to want to know anything from you? Do you think he's going to want you to, he would say that you're a good witness or not? No, because you're just now driving up to a scene of accident that has already taken place. He's not going to ask you a bunch of questions about what took place at this accident because you were not there to see it, to witness it. You were not involved in it in any way. You have just happened up on the scene. If you got a summons from the court saying that you are supposed to testify in a court matter, are they going to ask you to come testify about something you have no idea? You weren't there. You don't know any of the people. You don't know anybody that was involved with this case. Are they going to ask you to come up on the stand and be the witness for the prosecution or the defense because you have information? No, you don't have any information because you don't have any knowledge of the case. You can only share, you're only a good witness if you were there, if it's something you experienced, if it's somebody that you've talked to. So when you think about going to witness, going to share the gospel with others, simply tell them what you know. Simply tell them what happened to you. Now, if you remember back when we first started this group of lessons, and it's in verse number 10, it says, "Finally, my brethren." Brethren is speaking to those that are brothers and sisters in Christ. They are those that are saved. That's what all of these verses are. Who all of these verses are talking to is those that are already saved. If you have been saved, then you have a witness. You have a testimony to share. You are a witness that you know Jesus Christ. You are a witness that he is real, that he is real in your heart, that he is that he has come to indwell in you. You are witness to that. You have experienced that. So that's simply what you are to share. I want you to turn in your Bibles to John chapter 20. Go to John chapter 20. And let's look at some scripture here in John chapter 20. I think about whenever I got saved, how wonderful that it was. And I can have told many people about the day I got saved. And I want to go back and think about what it was like before I got saved. Before I was saved, Preacher Lockie was my pastor. And he would say so many times, I don't know if it was every message, but it felt like it was every message, so many times through the years that I was under his preaching for 8 years before I was saved, that he would say, is your name written in the Lamb's Book of Life? I've just asked that question to you. You have answered it to yourself. Every time he asked that question, I would respond in some way of saying, I think it's there. Ain't it there? It must be there. I always had this little bit of I hoped it was there. But not that hope like it was secure hope. It was a very insecure hope that I had. So it always made me question, and it made me nervous when preacher would ask, is your name written in the Lamb's Book of Life? Because I just wasn't real sure. And I wasn't exactly sure how to find out and how to know. And this was something that I was actively talking to my husband about. I was actively talking to my best friend about. And I had a lot of questions within myself. I was searching for preaching on the radio. I was flipping through the Bible, and I was very confused about what I read. And something that I kept asking over and over again was for Todd and for my best friend Donna to tell me about when they got saved. And was there something about their testimony that was different than when I had prayed the prayer when I was young? And I didn't understand why that I was confused and why that I didn't have any peace about that. And also, the same year that I got saved, Preacher Lockie was preaching through the book of Revelation on Wednesday night. It was a very lengthy every Wednesday night, and he did this for months and months on end. And I was faithful to church, because I just kept thinking there's something that I'm missing, and it's got to be at church. It's going to be where I find it is at church. And when I would get there, then Preacher would be preaching on Revelation on Wednesday nights, and it would make me very nervous. I would feel very uneasy. It made me think about, is my name really in that book? Am I going to be one of those that he comes back for? Or am I going to get left behind? And so all of that made me very, very nervous. And anytime I read my Bible, I always felt like, and I shared this with my husband on many occasions, I would read something and I would ask him to explain it to me. And I would tell him several times, I know I hear what you're saying in my head. I hear what you're saying, but I just feel like there's something there that I don't see. And there's something that I don't quite understand. While you've got your place at John chapter 20, I want you to go down to verse number 29. And we're going to be looking at Thomas. Now, Jesus has died on the cross. He was buried, and he has risen again. Now, Thomas at this point has not seen the Lord. He has been told that the Lord is alive. He has been told that by others who have seen him that he is alive, that he is no longer in the grave. Now, this is how Thomas responds. Verse number 29, Jesus is talking to Thomas, and Jesus saith unto him, Thomas, because thou hast seen me, thou hast believed. Now, Thomas believed after he saw the Lord, but he couldn't believe their account of it without seeing him. And we'll talk about that some more in just a minute. It says, blessed are they that have not seen, yet have believed. Now, sometime after that I was saved, and there's lots and lots of verses that I can testify to, that I'm a witness to, that I can share my testimony about, is there's so many scriptures that have just lit off the page. That did not happen until after that Monday night when I was saved. And then when I read my Bible, it was just coming alive. It was like light bulbs were just going off all the time. Not that I completely comprehend every single word of the Bible. There are still so many truths in there that I am still learning, and I'm still growing. But for the most part, it's just popping off the page to me. And every time that I would read, I would be so excited. The very first time that I read John chapter 20 and verse number 29, and I saw that he tells Thomas, because thou hast seen me, thou hast believed. Now, this is the part that got me excited. Blessed are they that have not seen and yet have believed. Blessed are they that have not seen. I have not seen Jesus with my physical eyes. I have seen him spiritually. I heard his voice spiritually. I know he was talking to me when he told me that even the devil and the demons believe and you're just a believer. And what I had was a head knowledge of Jesus Christ. I knew about him. I had read about him, but I had never met him. But on that Monday night in July of the year 2000, on the 18th, at youth camp, I met him. I was almost 29 years old, and I met him at my church. I met him back in a little Sunday school class at a little brown wooden desk. I met him. He met me. He came to me that Monday night and showed me that I was lost. I saw him with my physical eye, with my spiritual eyes. When my spiritual eyes were opened, all that time that the word, I would just see, I know there was something more that I couldn't see, that I couldn't get. I was starting to see those things after that Monday night. Whenever I read that blessed are they that have not seen and yet have believed, he was talking about me. And if you're saved, he is talking about you. Blessed are you that have not seen him physically, but you have seen him spiritually. You have seen him. You have believed without having to see his physical body, without having to touch his physical flesh. Now, Thomas, this is how Thomas believed. Let's go back up a few verses here. It says in verse number 24, but Thomas, one of the 12, called Didymus, was not with them when Jesus came. The other disciples therefore said unto him, we have seen the Lord. So they're telling him that he hasn't seen him physically. They have. They're telling him, but he said unto them, except I shall see in his hands the print of the nails, and put my finger into the print of the nails, and thrust my hand into his side, I will not believe. Thomas could not fathom how this could be true. He could not understand with his mind. He could not understand how this could be so. That the Lord could be alive when he saw him on that cross. He witnessed his death, and now he's going to witness him being in a physical form. And those that believe, like me and you, we believe without having to see him in his physical form. We have seen him with our spiritual eyes. He has made himself known unto us, and he did that for Thomas. He blessed Thomas by showing himself to him, and he knew the questions that he had. He knew the shock that he was in. And he said, then when he said in verse number 29, because thou hast seen me, thou hast believed. Blessed are they that have not seen and yet have believed. And that's talking about me. That's talking about you. And any time that you're reading your Bible or you're praying about something, and maybe that the pastor preaches on something that you're praying about, and the pastor don't have any idea, but God knows, and God knows how to direct him and to say or share something that only you and him know about. And it will come through maybe a song, maybe somebody's going to share something that they've read, and maybe what they've read has something to do with what you've been praying about. And you are excited because you know that you just had a personal one-on-one relationship with Lord Jesus Christ, and you have something that you can share. Just like me sharing this verse with you today. Well, that was one of the many, many verses that just popped out to me. And then I have shared that with you, and I have shared that with others. I am witnessing. I am sharing the gospel. I am sharing what the Lord has done for me. So anytime that you feel pressure or you feel nervous about being a witness to something, about being a witness for Christ, think about that it's your personal testimony. If you go back to what I've shared, the pastor had a testimony to share with me about when he got saved. My best friend Donna, she shared with me her testimony. That, for some reason, when I was lost, that's what I craved hearing, because I saw in them something that I didn't have. There would be several different people at my home church at West Lenoir. One was a lovely little lady named Miss Triplett. I loved it whenever Miss Triplett would share her testimony, because there was always something about the way she shared it, about how personal, about how it was almost as if she had met him face to face. And I just could not understand why I had not met him face to face like she had, until that Monday night when I felt like that I had met him face to face, when I felt like that he actually, I have a relationship with him. I know him as if it is a physical person in front of me, but I know him, and it was through the spiritual eyes that had been opened and the spiritual ears that were opened that Monday night. So when you think about sharing your testimony, don't get nervous that you're going to say something wrong or get something wrong, because it's your testimony. It's your experience. That's what you share. That's what would make a good witness on the stand in a courtroom, is for that witness to testify to what they saw, to what they heard, to what they experienced. That's what you're doing. If you're going to think about yourself on a witness stand and you're getting asked these questions, you can only answer the questions that you have absolute knowledge about, to what you know. And what you know, if you're saved, is you know the night that he, or the day, or the morning, or whatever the circumstance was, you know when he saved you. And you know what words that he used to open your spiritual ears. So when you think about trying to get everything just right, there's no right or wrong. It's your testimony. It's your experience that you share. Just like my husband's testimony about the night that he got, or the day that he got saved, is completely different than the day that my best friend Donna got saved. They're completely different circumstances. They were completely different places at completely different ages. But yet there was something about each one of those, and Miss Triplett, about her testimony, that was something that I needed to hear. That was something just so I could recognize that they had something that I didn't have. And then that Monday night when the Lord came to me, and he offered me that salvation, he offered me forgiveness for the things that I had done, I received salvation that night. Now, if you go back and look at the scripture again, let's go back over to Ephesians. Keep your place here in John, because we're going to go back to the book of John here in a few minutes. But keep your place and turn back to Ephesians and look one more time at verse number 15. I want you to notice something. And your feet shod with the preparation of the gospel of peace. It doesn't just stop with the gospel. And it could. The gospel of peace. Now, like I had shared before, I was very uneasy when Preacher Lockie would ask if your name's written in the book of life. I was very uneasy when Preacher Lockie, every Wednesday night for a very, very long time, was preaching through the book of Revelation, until that Monday night that I got saved. Now, Preacher was still preaching through Revelation during that year that I got saved. The difference was, I now had this peace about me. It didn't make me nervous anymore when he was reading about all that was going to take place here on earth, when the Lord comes back to get his bride, and when the rapture and everything takes place, and all the events that are going to unfold as a result of all that, I'm not going to be here for that. I know my name is in the book of life. I know when Jesus comes back for his bride that I get to go, that I am going with him, that I will be leaving this earth and going to heaven. I know that. That gives me such peace. I'm not nervous whenever somebody's preaching out of Revelation anymore. Now, I am. What it did change was how I viewed everybody else. Then I started to wonder and worry and be concerned and pray for somebody else. Lord, are they saved? Do they know that they're going to heaven? Are they going to heaven? I started praying for people. I was so not concerned about myself anymore. And I was to have turned my concern and my prayers to others, because I had a peace. I know where I'm going. If I die today, and I very well could, the death doesn't, there's no age limit. There's no age requirement. I don't have to get to 80 or 90, but I could go today and I know I will be in heaven. I know my name is written in the Lamb's Book of Life, and I am so excited that if I hear Preacher Lockie say, Is your name written in the Lamb's Book of Life? I could raise my hand in excitement that I know my name is there. It excites me for that question to be asked, where before I had fear. Now it's excitement. That's what peace does. That's why it's called the gospel of peace. It gives you peace about anything that you're going through. And it doesn't mean that everything's just been smooth sailing. There's been lots of trials. There's been lots of tribulation. There's been lots of things that have taken place that have been hard and difficult and scary and just very, very difficult. But in the midst of all that, the Lord would comfort me. The Lord would love on me. The Lord would correct me when I needed correction. And I can have peace, and I do have peace in spite of my circumstances. Before, I only felt good when the circumstances were good, and then I felt bad when the circumstances were bad. Now, I still don't like it when circumstances are not good, but I can have peace in the midst of them. I can be happy. My joy is not based on my circumstances. Now, I'm just like everybody else, and I like the circumstances to go well, but I can have joy and peace and happiness in the midst of awful circumstances, and I have been through some awful circumstances, and I'm sure you have too. And if you've been saved any amount of time, you know the peace I'm talking about. You know what it's like whenever you just don't understand why that loved one died before that they were an older person, or why that this hardship has come in here, or why that job was lost, or why this, or why that, or why that accident happened. You don't have to, you don't worry as much as you have comfort in the midst of it, and you have peace in the midst of it. Now, I want you to go back to the book of John real quick. I want us to turn to, let's turn to chapter 15. I want to share this this one last thing with you, John chapter 15, to kind of sum up what we're talking about. And I want you to look at verse number 16, John 15, and verse number 16. And this is what the Lord, this is red letter. If you're reading this in your Bible, if you're following along in your Bible, you have red letters, and that means Jesus is saying this himself. These are from his lips. Ye have not chosen me, but I have chosen you and ordained you that you should go and bring forth fruit, and that your fruit should remain, that whatsoever ye shall ask of the Father in my name, he may give it you. Ye have not chosen me, but I have chosen you. Ye have not chosen me, but I have chosen you. This was not my bright idea. This was not your bright idea. This was his perfect idea. You have been chosen by him. You have been chosen to share the gospel. That's what this is talking about. And ordained you. The Lord has chosen you, and he has ordained you. He has commissioned you to share the gospel, to have fruit. Now, we don't make the fruit. The vine makes the fruit. Branches, fruit comes out on a branch. If you ever been around a grapevine, there's a massive vine at the bottom of that grapevine that goes into the root system, and then you have all these branches that feather out, and the fruit hangs from those branches. The branch isn't making that fruit. The vine, the source of the life, is making the fruit. He's just using a branch to have that fruit on. We are a branch. He's the vine. We are the branches. He's producing the fruit, and we're just being that obedient branch, stretching our arms out to others, and we're going to be producing fruit. He's going to give us fruit through us being the branch, because he has chosen us and he has ordained us. And we will bring forth fruit, not our fruit, his fruit. The source of the fruit comes from the vine. Remember that. The vine is what decides what the fruit is. The vine is where the life is. He is the vine. He is the life. He's the light of the world. He is everything that we need. He is life everlasting. And that fruit is going to be produced from him, but he chooses to use us. He has chosen you. He has chosen me. He has ordained you. He wants, and what that boils down to is that he just wants you to share what you have experienced. He wants you to share with somebody about the day that you got saved. And you may say, well, I don't have a very strong testimony. I don't have very much to say. It could be the simplest little thing. It's not about fancy words. It's not about having all this proper, eloquent, fancy religious stuff to say. It's just about sharing. Hey, I was a Monday night and I was at church. And I was sitting there listening to the preacher, and the preacher was preaching, and he said that over in the book of Mark, that when Jesus came up onto the shore, that the demoniac man was standing there, and that the demons inside the demoniac man, and there was a legion of them. They were called legion. There were so many of them, and they recognized who Jesus was, and they were worried about what Jesus was going to do with them, and they recognized who he was, but yet they did not serve him. They did not worship him. They were not following him. They were in awe of him, but they were not worshiping and they were not serving him. And that's what I was doing. I knew who he was from reading up and hearing about him, but I didn't know him personally. I wasn't following him personally. I didn't have a personal relationship with him. And that's my testimony. What's your testimony? That's what you share. That's how you be a witness. That's how you put those shoes on. That's how you have your feet shod with the preparation of the gospel of peace. Share your testimony because it's powerful. It's more powerful than you believe. Man, he's chosen you and he's ordained you to do that. Let us pray. Dear Heavenly Father, I thank you so much for this message. I thank you, Lord, for how you have helped me so much to be more bold in my witness, because I'm simply sharing what you've done for me. I'm simply sharing with somebody else all the wonderful things that you show me in your word, Lord, how there's so many verses that just pop off the page. I have my Bible so marked up and highlighted and circled because there's so many things, Lord, that you have just shown me over the last 20 years that I've been saved. I love you, Lord. I thank you, Lord. I pray, Lord, that we'd be not just a hearer of your word, but we'd be a doer of it also. We'd go out and share our testimony with somebody today. I love you and I praise you in Jesus' name. Amen.